hrvatske policije.
Idemo.
Nemojte mi brata dirati. Nemojte mi brata dirati.
Marco
Francisković,
we got an incredible story and we're going to be sharing that with you. He's going to take us to the center and we're going to get into some history. We're going to get into his story, how he came to this deen, to Islam. Don't go anywhere.
This is the deen show. This is the deen,
First part of the tour. Where are we at now, Marco?
We are now in Zagreb. This is part of the old town called Kaptol. It is a part where is a church, Catholic church property. Before, some 100 years ago, this was all inside the walls, you know, protected walls. It was isolated area. It was occupied by Hungarians invaders, and they built this cathedral, this church. It's called Church of Saint Stephen, but it is not the Saint Stephen from the Bible who was the first martyr, who was killed by Pharisees because he pronounced that Jesus is Messiah. No, it's a kind of trick. So the domestic people think it's a saint from the Bible, but it's the Hungarian king István Árpád, which this cathedral is named. But to explain to the viewers, what does it mean? This is like there was a Croatian war recently, and there were some Serbs who were occupying part of the Croatia, and to have and they are now gone. Yeah. But if they were in some other time, a town called Knin. So this is kind of lunacy to have this cathedral with this name and to call him a saint, because he was an occupier. He made a genocide against Croatian people in these old times. And now Croatians, who forgot their history, are entering in and they are praying to his statue of former occupier.
Yeah.
And it is an example of what happens when people forgot their history. Their enemies become their saints.
Wow, that's deep. Their enemies become their saints.
Their saints.
That was one of the things when you went back, because you're a Croatian by nationality. When you went back and you were searching in the Bible to come back and connect, you started to research. One of the first things you mentioned to me was the first commandment in the Bible kind of like opened your eyes.
Yes, because the first commandment is very clear. There is no doubt about it. What it says, that don't make any idols, don't make any pictures, don't make anything, don't represent it as a god, because God cannot be represented in any pictures in any form. And Christians should oblige by the book that they are following. When I saw this dichotomy inside the Bible, then I started to research more. So I found out all the hidden history of my people, but not only of Croatian people, of Europe, and finally of the world, because everything is connected. If you are studying enough time and deeply enough and committed, if you are committed to the study, you must come to the truth. That's the point. Wherever you from, whatever point you are getting.
All right, let's continue on. So that was deep right there, the first commandment. Thou shalt have no other gods except the one God.
Yeah,
no graven
images. You can see here all the statues.
Yeah.
And
so this is where people really get, when they're thinking, they're not just following blindly when they see all the idols, statues.
Croatian church, before the occupation from the Hungarians here on the north and the Venetians on the south, it was unilateral church. It was called Glagoljaši. We had our own writing, unique writing. It's not Cyrillic writing, it's not Latinic, it was specific original writing. And we had our our church, independent church, from the Vatican and from the Byzantium. But this occupation happened 9 centuries ago, more than 9 centuries ago, and during this time, during all these centuries, step by step, they erased most of our history from the mainstream, sort of saying, you know. So today we are witnessing that this church, which was built up by our occupiers and by very bloodthirsty people and rulers, now they are worshipped as saints.
All right, so now we're heading over to this monument, the statue that was created for someone who's looked at as what in Croatia?
Our biggest national hero. His name is Ban is the title, Josip Jelačić. And he finally liberated Croatia for at least some short time. Afterwards he was killed, murdered, poisoned. From these Hungarians here, so he liberated this capital. This capital is like a green zone of U.S. troops in Baghdad, but it lasted here for some more than 7 centuries. This green zone, occupied green zone, and this you will see over there. This Ban Jelačić in 1848, he gathered his army. It was a revolutionary time. I have to give a context. It was a revolution time in all over to Europe, and it is connected also with these new ideas of the revolution, fueled by Marx and Engels and all this stuff. So these Hungarian nationalists in Budapest said, there is no Croatia, there is no Croatian people, all this Croatian territory is Hungarian. And Ban Jelačić formed his army with Croatians and Bosnian also volunteers, which is very interesting. They are fighting together. From the Bosnia, many of the soldiers, volunteers, people came to join his army, and they marched to the Budapest, and they totally defeated this Hungarian army, which was kind of miracle, because the Hungarian army was stronger, bigger, and at home place. You know? So he defeated it.
So this is there's one interesting thing you told us about this statue that we're looking at, is that on his sword there was something that was connected with what?
Yeah, this is a fascinating story. This sword which Ban Jelačić is holding, it is a gift from the Bosnian Beg. Beg is also a title of the local local elite. Beg Bašić gave from Bosnia, gave this sword and horse also as a gift to the Ban Jelačić. Sword is famous Damascian sword. It is now forgotten secret of the Damascian steel, which is more durable and more flexible than famous katana swords. So this Damascian sword was given to the Ban Jelačić. And on the sword, it is engraved near the handle. On one side, it is engraved Taqwa Allah. On the other side, it is engraved, there is no hero like Ali, and there is no sword like Zulfikar. Zulfikar is a sword from that Melek Jibril gave to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And later, it was gifted to the Ali when he proved himself by defeating the enemy in the battle.
So can we take this away from what you're saying, that on this sword right here, where are we right now? We're in the center of...
This is the main square of the capital of the Croatia,
of
Zagreb.
Croatia, Zagreb. So yes. This person is a hero for the Croatian people.
Biggest,
right?
Croatian national hero.
Okay. Biggest Croatian national hero. And on his sword, it has the saying of God, of Allah, on his sword.
Yes.
Conscious, Taqwa Allah.
Yeah.
Taqwa Allah. So that means like have taqwa of Allah, have consciousness of your creator. Of the creator, you know, Jesus said Allah ha. So when we say Allah, that's the Semitic language.
Right.
That's the creator. So that's on his sword, is to remember God, Allah.
Yeah.
It's there. I mean, you're an academic. This is going to be verified. How does someone, if they said, come on, you're waking me up.
You can go in the Croatian National Museum. Yeah. The sword is there exhibited. You can read it. I will send you pictures so you can put it in the video. There's no problem to confirm it.
That's deep, right? That's deep.
But my explanation of this, I see in this a sign of Allah, sign of God. like to tell us all that he is the one who is leading everything. He is leading the history. Even Ban Jelačić wasn't a Muslim. He was a Catholic Christian. But in this way, this is a sign that Allah is leading even non-believers.
If someone is, because could
if somebody is fighting for the just thing,
for justice,
right?
There's a saying from Prophet Muhammad that God Almighty will support even someone who's not a believer in the pure monotheism. Mm-hmm. Let's say he's from another religion, but he's a just Christian. He's a just ruler. He's just. He's a just human being. God Almighty will support that just human
being.
And
he was very beloved by our people. And I'm saying not only people in Croatia, but also people in Bosnia. There is also some other background to this. Why was he gifted by this sword from the Bosnian Beg Bašić?
Yeah.
Because in Bosnian history, there was a revolt against Ottoman Empire by this Gradašević, if you know about him, if you heard of him in Bosnian history. And the Ottoman Empire, because Bosnians wanted their independence. That was in the time of the 1830s, when the Ottoman Empire declined and other entities got their independence. And even Ottoman Empire gave the independence, autonomy to the Serbs, to the Orthodox. So Bosnian Muslims asked Ottoman ruler, so you gave to the Orthodox Serbs, give us also the same independence, and they were denied. So there was a armed rebellion, and the Ottoman army crushed this rebellion very strongly,
yeah.
And with lots of bloodshed. So some 10 years after this rebellion, Ban Jelačić was he was a commander of the garrison near the border of the Bosnia from the, it was Austro-Hungarian Empire at that time. And nearby on the other side was the Turkish military post. Not Bosnian, but made of just Turks from Turkey. Because to crush the Bosnian rebellion, Turks, Ottoman Empire, had to import Turks, not because local population didn't want to fight their own Bosnian brothers. So there was some incident with this Turkish military post across the border, and Ban Jelačić, on his own, without permission from the Vienna, crashed this Turkish outpost, and Bosnians were pleased to see Turks defeated. So this is the reason why the Bosnian Beg Bašić gifted this sword and this horse. Horse was named Emir. The translation of Emir is ruler. It is an Arabic name for the ruler. And they gifted him this horse and this sword. And he was beloved by the Bosnian people, because finally somebody defeated the Turks, who killed a lot of Bosnians at that time during these political problems in Bosnia, in Ottoman Empire. And some 10 years later, when this revolutionary time came into Hungary and whole of Europe, when Ban Jelačić started gathering his army to defend against Hungarians, this is the reason why lots of Bosnian volunteers from Bosnia came and joined Ban Jelačić's army. And this is also funny thing, kind of funny, no? As they came from the Ottoman Empire, Bosnians, they wore Turkish uniforms. So when Hungarians saw Ban Jelačić marching with soldiers, some of them are wearing Turkish uniform, they thought, he got some deal with the Turks. So it was kind of a psychological war, which was not planned, but it worked out. So they got easier demoralized the Hungarian army, so they gave up. And victory was easier for Ban Jelačić. For me also, this historical example of unity between Bosnia and Croatia is for me example how we should do in the future. Because unfortunately in this latest war, there was a period when Croatian government and Bosnian, there was a war between Croatians and Bosnians in Croatia, you know, that unfortunately happened. And it didn't benefit anybody. It was just bad politics, very bad politics. So I am referring to this historical example, that when we are united when we are not separated, then we can, in interest of both people, defeat our enemies and gather liberty.
So we're here in the center of Zagreb. This is in the Balkans, Croatia.
Okay, this, we just passed this small street here down some 15-20 meters left. This is a small street which is called Bloody Bridge. Uh-huh. It's a small street over the left. We can film it when we go back. And this is called why? Because here was a boundary between Kaptol, this Hungarian occupied zone in Zagreb, and Gradec, which was domestic part with the domestic population. And this was the connecting port, connecting bridge between one part of the city and occupied part of the city. And there were lots of fighting over there. So people called it, and it was established as such a name, the Bloody Bridge Street.
Yeah.
Because of this constant fighting with these Hungarian occupiers, which domestic people didn't want to accept. You know, they had some rebellion moments to give some resistance to the occupiers.
So continuing on in your story, you actually ended up in prison as a political prisoner. You wrote something on your Facebook page. We won't go too much into the politics, but you can touch upon it. But the end result was you end up in prison and someone exposes you to the Quran.
Right.
Talk about that.
Right. Well, I was in this cell with all other seven cellmates. There were two Muslims. One was Muslim who didn't practice Islam at all. And the other was from Bosnia, Salafi, from Salafi version of Islam. And when I was imprisoned, it was the time of Ramadan. So he fasted, he prayed regularly, and we connected. He was a regular guy, young guy. We worked out together and talked during the yard, walking in the yard. And his sentence was, he was at the end of his sentence. So still, I was still in the prison, he gave me a small pocket book of Quran.
Translation of the Quran?
Yes.
And that was in Croatian, Bosnian?
Yes, Croatian, Bosnian translation.
Okay.
Because Croatian, Bosnian are almost the same languages, just different names for the same language. So
you can throw in there Serbian, Croatian, Bosnian, whatever.
Montenegrin.
They all understand the same.
You don't have to have translation. We understand each other perfectly.
Okay. Yeah. So now what happens next?
So I stayed in the prison for months more. And during this, I read the Quran. And afterwards, when I was released, I started to research more about Islam, about or history of Islam and everything else which is connected with it. And I got deeper and deeper in it. And all the answers that I was looking for, I found over there. I was satisfied with that. And this is the shortest way to explain it, how it happened.
Talk to us about when you go back in history, the people that were living in the Balkans here, they were known, some say they were called the Bogomils, those dear to God. Mm-hmm. You can call them maybe Unitarian Christians, those who only believed in one God and that Jesus was a messenger, not God or one in three in the Trinity. Talk about the little bit of that history. Did that also have an impact on you when you started to study it and these things got to unfold?
As I parallel with this Islam, I always wanted to find more about my nation history. This is also part of the Croatian history, because before this occupation, which was I talking about earlier, from Hungarians here in the northern part of Croatia and Venetians and Crusaders on the southern part of Croatia, Croatia was not under the Pope, was not Orthodox. It had its original, unique way of Christianity. We had even, as I said, our own writing, Glagoljica. And these priests were called Glagoljaši, similar to this writing. And we had our own bishops and our own church hierarchy. And even it was, this is interesting, and it is compatible with Islam, it was allowed to have more women than one. not only that Jesus was not God and that idolatry was forbidden, but also was allowed to have more than one woman, which is
more wives.
So there are lots of connections with Islam when you go deep into history. But there is also some other interesting facts. For example, first written document of the Croatian who converted, who accepted Islam, is from Spanish Caliphate in Cordoba in mid 9th century.
So this is a Croatian now who also went to Spain
as mercenaries.
And he ended up accepting Islam.
Yes, yes. Because in this caliphate in Spain, caliphs hired Croatians, and this is interesting, only Croatians, and it was like a tradition for all the time, whole period when the caliphate was there, from the beginning to the end, Croatians were the caliph's Praetorian guard, their personal security. And they were like mercenaries. And quite a number of them accepted Islam, and they got nice, even got titles, positions in the state and so on. And the first written document of one of these mercenaries who converted to Islam is in mid 8th century, 9th century, sorry. And it was Hadži Badrov, was his name. Badrov is a Croatian surname. His origins from town of Šibenik in Croatia. So this is first document of Croatia, some of the Croatian nationality, to accept Islam. And it's funny thing that it is found in Cordoba in Spain. Wow. Would you never accept one thing to have, to see such a thing?
What do you say to Serbians or Croatians or people from Greece or Italy or whoever else, and they hear that you as a Croatian or they hear a Serb or someone else accepted Islam, and now they say, oh, he became a Turk?
Yeah, this is a derogatory term. You know, I see people who do that, I see them as ignorant. What can I do? They don't know what to say, something good, something smart. So they put this label on you, so they try to discredit you. But it doesn't matter to me. It's important that I'm sure in my beliefs, that I can defend them if necessary. I can explain them. And all the facts and all the history is working for me. Mm-hmm. And if somebody can oppose it, welcome, you know,
yeah.
You can. But usually when they... people who don't have proper answer, then they go this way to make some these terms which try to insult you and to make you look bad in any way. But it doesn't make this, and they think that here is usually this term, in especially in Bosnia, they call Muslims Turks.
Yeah.
But the fact is, the historical fact is that if you look genetically, by blood, Bosnians didn't mix with Turks because they were Muslims. But especially in Orthodox Serbia, the part of Ottoman Empire which was under the Ottomans for more than 400 years, there are lots of mixing of blood between Turks and Serbs. So this is a paradox that Serbs who have more Turkish blood in their nation, they are calling Bosnians who have absolutely no Turkish blood, they didn't have any mixing with Turks, almost none, they're calling them Turks. Maybe there are some complexes that are here manifested, I don't know.
What advice do you have for people? So you're without a shadow of a doubt, upon investigation, you know, deep scrutinization, you have confirmed that the Quran is not written by Muhammad, a group of men.
No.
But it's sent by the Creator for all of mankind.
Absolutely.
100%?
100%.
Do you believe that anyone who has a sincere heart and is looking to know the purpose of life, and they pray to the one Creator, God Almighty alone, that they will find exactly what you found in the Quran in Islam?
They will find if they are looking with an honest heart, with honest intentions. Absolutely. You know as well, many of them tried to denounce Quran, tried to prove that it is man-made. They all failed. And many of them converted to Islam in this process of trying to dispute the Quran and its holy origin.
Wow, that's deep. That's deep in the heart here of Zagreb with our brother here, showing that Islam transcends nationalism. It's for everyone. Doesn't matter if you're Croatian, Serbian, Italian, Polish, Bosnian, American. It's for everyone with that simple call to worship the Creator, not the creation. Be morally upright and be a good human being.
Right.
We'll be right back with more. Yeah. Assalamu alaikum.
What is that? This is a shrine.
A shrine. Okay, shrine. There's a shrine over there.
How is it called? Mother of God.
So are you saying that they believe what? That shrine is... How does that connect
holy,
to...
Holy, it's a shrine of...
Mary?
Virgin Mary, which is called Mother of God because Jesus is considered to be God. So she is Jesus' mother, so she is Mother of God, which is... we know it's nonsense, but it is belief.
Now, this is extremely important, and never are we trying to disparage or put down anybody's faith. Just bringing some things of truth, very important, crucial to what we call salvation, more important than anything that you can imagine, because when we die, this is the thing that even connects what you have in the Bible not to do. So we're going to be talking about this very important, these very important things that really nullifies a person's good deeds, really cancels out any kind of, you know, connection with their Creator, because this is what's called shirk, this associating partners with God. You were showing us over here that, you know, because in Islam we believe all thanks and praise is to the Creator of the heavens and earth, the same way Jesus praised God and taught us to, he would actually condemn these things if he was alive today. So tell us right now, you were showing me where they were having, what was those?
Thankful notes.
Yeah, thankful notes. Talk, what?
Well, they were saying, thank you, Mother of God, for saving us, saving our children, or whatever need they had, and they prayed here, and they got, they connected it to their prayings to be answered. So they put, lots of people put these thankful notes on the wall. And this is how this idolatry is feeding itself.
They're going upstairs now. Can we go up there?
No. It's only for...
You were telling us also through that door.
This is the main reason why we are here.
Yeah.
Because here are the headquarters of the Brothers of the Croatian Dragon, the Society of the Brothers of the Croatian Dragon, who are successors of the long time ago established Order of the Knights of the Dragon, which is established by the King Sigmund of Luxembourg, who was a king of the Holy Roman Empire. Mm-hmm. And to put it in perspective in today's time, this Order of the Knights of the Dragon were like special forces of NATO Pact today. And their main task in that time was to fight the heretics. And who were the heretics? Who church, pope, and priest of the church pointed finger at that he is heretic. He was heretic, and immediately right to execute him or to burn him alive or whatever methods Inquisition did choose to do. No. So these knights of the...
They were part of the Inquisitions?
Yeah, part of the Inquisition. And this is the method how they fought against... The main target was in Bosnia, Bosnian Bogumils or Church of Bosnia, who are not willing to submit to the Pope. Because this was the remain, as I said, the whole area of today Croatia and Bosnia was not under the Pope. But this Croatian part was occupied while the Bosnian part was left for some time to be out of influence of the Pope. So they formed these Knights of the Order of the Dragon to have their, breakdowns, to take a bit by bit of the land of the Bosnia and to submit all the people in the Bosnia under the Pope.
Yeah. So technically, these people probably would have had Jesus killed, Abraham killed, Moses killed, Prophet Muhammad, because they all would have not been in line with what they were preaching and teaching, because all these messengers came with the same message: worship the one creator, not the creation. Not to worship human beings, not to put an intermediary between you and the creator, not to worship the creation, statues, idols, giving thanks to, you know, like many of these rituals that are being seen today. They all preached against this. They all called people to have a direct connection, that pure monotheism with the one God. So anybody who went against that,
right.
I mean, and you be the judge of that right now. What makes more sense to you? That you only worship the one who created you, or you worship a messenger, a saint, you know, a dead person in the ground? You know, many people reject mm-hmm. that, the Trinity. Many people, by their innate nature, they reject this anyway.
Right, right. Because if you go by your logic, by your sense of reason, there is only one creator. There cannot be two or more of them. There is only one. Everything in the nature, if you dismantle it, if you go deep enough, you will find there is only one source of everything. And it's undeniable. But why it is undeniable? Then the forces who are preaching the different theology, they have to to force you to accept their version of religion and theology. So who doesn't want to be subjected to them willfully, it will be subjected by the force or killed. And this is what happened here during the centuries.
That's ironic, because usually people who have very little academic knowledge, the lay person or someone who might be an academic but suddenly glosses mm-hmm. over history, they try to make Islam look barbaric, you know, saying that if you're Muslim, you're terrorist.
You're primitive.
But it's interesting. You see the opposite happening when you're studying history,
right.
The true history.
Now I remember another example. This was not only happening here in the area of today's Croatia and Bosnia. This was happening all over Europe. For example, Charlemagne, you know, he's the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. Charles, King Charles. The Great,
okay.
Charles the Great. He, by force, he baptized and put under the wing of the Catholic Church and Pope all the Germanic tribes across the River Rhine, who were also Christians of this Unitarian version of Christianity. They were Christians, they were called Arian Christians by the Bishop Arie, because when council by the Constantine was in the year 323 in Nicaea was established, when Constantine put his force into this establishment of church and state, when he fused them together, there were some bishops who were against this Constantine move. One of them was Bishop Arie. This is why this is called Arian Christianity in this northern part of the Europe.
Yes.
And the same method was used over there. So all the Germanic tribes who didn't want to be under the Pope, under this kind of religion which was preached from the Rome, were brutally executed. In one day, there is a recording of that, King Charles the Great killed over 5,000 clan leaders of the Germanic tribe. He just decapitated the elite of his opponents. And this is interesting thing. Recently, Church Notre Dame burned, and this architecture is called Gothic architecture. But why it is called Gothic? Because Goths is another name for German tribes. But when you research history, you will see that in the places of today's Gothic cathedrals, not only Notre Dame, but there are Gothic cathedrals in other places, in Aachen, in Germany, in British Isles and other places, there are lots of Gothic cathedrals. But before Gothic cathedrals, there were these non-Roman, these old Christian churches were on their places. So the name Gothic and Gothic architecture was named because it was remembrance of the defeat of the Germans, of the Goths who were not under the Pope. This is this connection between the name of the Gothic architecture and this style. I don't know how much you are into this. This is the history of the architecture.
A lot of stuff here will continue on.
Yeah.
But it's very simple. I mean, for the layperson, God Almighty sent messengers, and they all came saying with the same message: worship the Creator, not the creation. If it's tricky, you're getting confused with all these things, which way to go? Have a sincere heart. Ask the Creator to guide you. We're trying to bring some historical things to light, so you can expose some of the commonalities. But the main thing is that all these messengers had the same message: worship the one God. Very simple, straightforward. We'll continue on here in Croatia. So you guys got to learn some interesting history. We're wrapping it up here. We're in Zagreb with our brother Marco. And wrapping up the story, you end up as a political prisoner. You get free of all the charges.
Most of them, the biggest charges.
The biggest charges. And then from there, you go to you're in the jail. You get exposed to the Quran. You confirm that the Quran is the verbatim word of God Almighty, Allah. You read it, put it to the test, no problems there, and you submit to all the things that it told you to do: worship one God, do good deeds, be a good human being. And now you're informally living Islam. Let's come towards the end. You're informally living Islam, and then all the way up into final decision that you actually are guided to meet some Muslims, and you end up taking your shahada.
Yeah, right. And this is how it happened. After I got out of the prison, maybe some less than 2 years was this period when I practiced and researched Islam for myself and prayed for myself without saying shahadat in proper way. You know. Maybe the main reason why I was a bit distanced from the Islamic center here in Zagreb is a political reason, because the leadership of the Islamic center here in Zagreb were pro-European Union. And this is what made me, I don't want to overgo that you disappointed me as well as Catholic Church, because bishops of the Croatian Catholic Church, Orthodox Church, all the nomenclature, rabbis, and Islamic leaders of the Islamic community here in Croatia, they were all together in advising and advocating the membership in the European Union. And I was very, very disappointed with that, because I cannot make it compatible Islamic values and Christians' values as well, which are represented in the Bible, compatible with the idea of European Union, which is secular, which means there is no God, that there is an evolution, that we are just a top breed of the animals, which is for me unacceptable. This is the reason why I was distanced. I didn't want to go to the Islamic Center. But as I was writing my book, my third book at that time, it was a strange story. I got in the dream message, or I had a dream that said me that I have to make akika. I didn't even know what akika is. So I searched it on internet, and I found out that is this procedure that where you have to, two of these lambs you have to sacrifice. And I had to do that, I had to go to the Islamic center. And then I met Mirza, who was very nice and open, and we eventually became friends. And this is how I started to go regularly, even to Juma, and I had my first Ramadan, and so on. And I'm continuing on this way until today.
It's interesting, you ended up shortly after that, is it right, you got married, and your wife even accepted Islam. Is she also Croatian?
Yes, she is also Croatian, also the same as me. Her parents are from Christian origin, from mother and father. She also accepted Islam, and then we got married.
Wow, that's amazing. Yeah. So both of you, this goes again to the common stereotypical thoughts that people have, not being able to separate. If you're a Serb, you have to be Orthodox Christian. If you're Croatian, you have to be Catholic. If you're Bosnian Muslim. So this Islam transcends all that. This is another proof that if you're seeking the truth, you want to know the purpose of life, doesn't matter if you're Croatian, Serbian, Italian, Polish, you'll find that in Islam.
Yeah, but it is important thing to emphasize, not to judge Islam by Muslims. because you will find a lot of bad Muslims and wrong interpretation of Islam, but you have to accept and find Islam in Quran, in the verified Hadith and all other sources, and in your behavior, in your heart. I can say it, the best way to find it, to find the truth, is to search deeply into your heart.
Can you translate that into Croatian, what you just said? Važno je da ne.
Da, znači važno je da se, bitno je da se ne procjenjuje islam po muslimanima. A ako će se po muslimanima gledati islam, onda to može biti, ima puno grešaka, ima puno loših muslimana. Nego islam se treba gledati po Kuranu, po hadisima vjerodostojnim i po svim dobrim stranama koje je islam ostavio iza sebe i koji su neporecivi, koji su lako dokazivi.
Kako znaš da je Kur'an objavlja od Boga, od Allaha? Kako znaš?
Znači, Kur'an je čudo sam za sebe. Kur'an is a miracle for
I want you to say it in the language.
Ne, znači, Kur'an je čudo sam za sebe, jer, znači, Bog je dao objavu prvo Mojsiju, židovima, ali dao ljudima. I ljudi su to slabo čuvali i ta objava se korumpirala i pokvarila. A onda je došla i druga objava po Isusu. I ta objava isto se izgubila i ljudi su to slabo čuvali. I onda je Bog stvoritelj rekao, sad ću ja paziti na ovu moju objavu i obećajem da niko neće moći promijeniti ovu objavu koju ja dajem poslaniku Muhammedu, mir bio s njim. I možemo svjedočiti u ovih tisuću, skoro 500 godina, nema ni jedne promjene, znači koliko god ima frakcija među muslimanima, znači tu nema jedinstva među muslimanima, ima i šija, ima sunija, ima raznih drugih, ali svi imaju isti Kur'an. I to je apsolutni dokaz da, znači, da Božja volja, znači, stoji u toj zaštiti i da potvrđuje se ono što je obećano i što je rečeno. I niko to još nije mogao, niti je do sada, to sam baš istraživao, jer to su te stvari koje su me navodile i koje su mi dale sigurnost, znači, da nema nikoga koji je uspio osporiti ove stvari, da je Kur'an nepromjenjiv i vječan.
Šta je glavna message from the Quran?
Bog je jedan. Nema drugih bogova, samo jedan Bog. To je glavna stvar. I Muhammed je njegov prorok.
A Isus?
Isus je jedan u nizu proroka i to je vrlo bitan prorok. Znači, Isus je Mesija. Znači, u Kuranu to je bitno naglasiti. Znači, da između islama i kršćanstva, sad bilo ono, svih ovih raznih verzija opet kršćanstva, svejedno, da li katoličko, protestantsko, pravoslavno, tu je Isus Mesija. Znači, Mesija je onaj koga je Bog poslao židovskom narodu po obećanju da će dobiti svog Mesiju. Židovi su ga odbacili. Isus je uzašao na nebo. To se točno zna, ima u Jeruzalemu, ono kad sam bio, točno ima mjesto, u sklopu džamije je mjesto Isusovog uzašašća na nebo. I Isus će se vratiti na kraju vremena. Znači, po islamskoj eshatologiji, jednako kao i po kršćanskoj eshatologiji, tu nikakve razlike nema. Isus je Mesija koji se vraća na kraju vremena, koji će se boriti i pobijediti Antikrista po kršćanskom, odnosno muslimanski, to je Dejjal. To je isto biće. Antikrist i Dejjal. Znači, po tome je kršćanstvo i islam potpuno kompatibilni i slični, a razlike su upravo u ovoj dimenziji, znači da Isus nije Bog, da Isus nije dio trojstva i jednostavno da se normalno Bogu ne pridružuje niko drugi, jer on je jedan, jedini i nema nikoga drugog osim njega.
Kako bi definisirao islam i muslim? How would you define islam and muslim in your language?
Znači, islam i musliman je čovjek koji slijedi uputu koja mu je dana, znači obavlja svih onih pet propisanih dužnosti, obavezno je, znači, molitva pet puta dnevno, i to je u biti, nažalost, eto, to ono što sam rekao na početku, nemojte gledati islam po muslimanima, stvarnost je takva da, ja mislim, čak po nekim statistikama, preko 90% nominalnih muslimana ne drži se toga, ne klanja redovito, ne obavlja tu praksu i onda se čudimo zašto onda u svijetu, pogotovo u muslimanskom svijetu, vlada takav nered i eto, takva kako je stanje, loše. Znači, upravo zato jer ljudi ne žele da im bude loše. Misle da mogu bez Boga, a ne mogu bez Boga. Znači, moraju se podložiti Božjim zakonima i onda će ih bodi, onda dolazi sve druge nagrade.
Ja, kako bi predao taj reč? Muslim is one who submits to the will of the creator.
Tako je, znači, musliman je onaj koji se podčinjava volji stvoritelja.
The Islam, how would you translate this? Peace acquired by submission to the will of the creator.
Da, znači, mir postignut podčinjavanjem volji stvoritelja.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
So you got it in English, you got it in Bosnian, Croatian, Serbians can understand this.
I can even now continue in English. Maybe this is important thing to mention in my journey to the Islam, which started when I was student of economics here in Zagreb, university in Zagreb. I studied economics and I got in touch with a book, old book from Saint Thomas Aquinski, from the Catholic theologian from the 12th century. And there he explained why usury is wrong and why it is forbidden in the Bible. Then I didn't know much about Islam, almost nothing. But it is very strictly forbidden for Christians to have usury. And in this book I read as a student explanation why usury is wrong and why it's making all these bad things for the one who produces, it makes disbalance in economic transfer of wealth and everything else. And in continuous research of this usury and theologic side and scientific side, eventually I found out all these historical things, how this happened, what is going on, who is ruling this world in this secular meaning, and finally got to this monetary system which is in power right now. So all around the world, the whole world is occupied and submitted not to the creator, but to the power of the money through usury. So if the mankind wants to be liberated, or some people or some nation wants to be liberated, it must be liberated from the monetary system of usury. And by researching this monetary system and how it is established and who is behind it, you can come to the answers who is doing all this evil in the world, why there are wars, pushing nations against nations, and especially in these times with these Zionist plans to create tensions and war between Christians and Muslims. So the Zionists can, in this clash which they want to project and they are working on it, to come as winners and rulers of the world. This is their plan, which is not even hard to find out if you look for it. They are even bragging with it, and they are feeling mightyful and powerful that nobody in the world can stop them. But there is a very simple way to stop them. It's not military way, because it's not realistic, but it's through the abolishment of this usury system. So if we want to fight Zionism, first and most, for me, this is my thinking, most important step is to spread the knowledge about usury and how the usury is serving this Zionist program and Zionist plans which they are promoting and forcing on all the humanity.
What advice do you have for, I have a friend, he's a Croatian background, he sat, he asked questions, he observed, he's intelligent, and he concluded at one point when he made the decision to accept Islam that obviously the Quran is from Allah, the Prophet Muhammad is a messenger, Jesus is not the son of God or one in three in the Trinity, but Jesus is a messenger of God. He accepted Islam. He came back home to Croatia and he got some, the word got out, someone started bantering him, giving him some problems, and it seemed like he backed off. Now he got a little bit spooked. What advice do you have for others like that who are out there and they're going against, you're very courageous, you're very brave. You got people who get in the ring and they fight and they think they are strong, but someone to recognize the truth and then cover it up, that's not courageous. But someone to recognize the truth, submit to it, and be courageous to come out of the closet with it like you have, to go against all the odds, that's commendable, that's courageous. What advice do you have for others who are listening to this, their heart recognized, their minds recognize what we're saying, the worship of the Creator, not the creation, the one God, Islam is the truth, the Quran is from the Creator, but now they're fearful more about what the people are going to say,
pressure.
Social pressure, what advice? Yeah.
Well, my advice is to be grateful for this trouble that they are going through, because this is a proof that they are on the right track. Because when you, in this world as it is, when this world and institutions of this world and all these who have position of power, if they are kind to you, then you have to question yourself, because obviously you're doing something wrong. But when they start this social pressure or some other problems that you are having, this is the sign that you are on the right way and you have to persist. And this is a test of your faith. Because easy is to have faith and to declare faith when everything is easy. But real test is in time of trouble. Then your heart is tested. And like gold. Gold is purified in fire. So this junk from the gold can be removed. So also our faith is tested in troubles that we are facing. So we can prove to ourselves primarily that we are strong, that our faith is real, that is not some kind of, I don't know how to say
fake.
Fake, yes, right, or weak. All this, be grateful for that. Or be grateful for everything, for good and for bad. Because you don't know, sometimes people think that something is good for them, but in reality it is bad for them. So it is best to give all this to the God and to be grateful for everything and persist in the way of the true one God, and this is it. There is no other God but Allah and one God.
If people want to learn more about your story, read some of your books, how could they get a hold of you?
They can get hold of me through the Facebook. I still have my Facebook profile. I have my YouTube channel, but I'm speaking on Croatian only. This is first time I'm having an interview in English for foreign audience. This book, Epistles of the Great Teacher, is translated in English. Inshallah, God willing, maybe there will be find some publisher. So for the English-speaking public, maybe will reach somebody, hopefully.
All right, thank you guys. Here in Zagreb, meeting our brother who's courageous enough, Marko.
Yes.
Who decided to step it up. He was seeking the truth. He read the Quran, connected with it, and we urge you, read a translation of the Quran and ask your Creator alone to guide you, and he will facilitate a way. Continue to tune in. Peace be with you. Salaam alaikum.
Salaam alaikum.